And after that, you had a series of cardiac events. At one point, you had like 5 within a few days.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, it's just this sort of weird thing where this was another 18 months after that instance. And, you know, what it sort of made a big change in my life. And I was working at an advertising agency in my local town. And I sort of, you know, it was a very sort of slow sort of business there. You know, a lot of people in my local town are older, and I work in digital advertising. So, you know, these people struggle to turn on a computer, let alone sort of buy and sort of make sales using digital means. So, you know, business was a little bit slow, and I sort of got given this tip, you know, like, why don't you move to London? And I was like, well, you know, I never really thought about it, to be honest. It never crossed my mind. And it was sort of in Australia, at least, you've sort of, Melbourne is your big sort of advertising capital. Sydney as well, but Melbourne mostly. And from where I live, Melbourne is a 3-day drive to get to Melbourne. So if I wanted to move my stuff down to Melbourne, I would have had to do a three-day okay. sort of drive to get there. Or I sort of thought to myself, well, why not just pack up everything and take a 3-day flight and go to London instead and sort of follow this advice. So I applied for a visa on a whim, and I was like, I'm not really sure if I'm going to get approved, but I'll go for it. And then 2 weeks later, the visa came back and it was all approved. And I don't know, I just sort of got this bug, and I got the visa on the Wednesday. On the Thursday, I went to a travel agent and said, I want a 1-way ticket to London. And then on the next Saturday, I left. And so everyone was a bit shocked. They're just like, I'm going to London next week, like, for good. I'll see you later. And yeah, so again, it's just, you know, so 18 months had gone by. I just moved to London. I had 50 kilograms of luggage. I sort of bought a second bag. So I had massive luggage with me. And some of these early hotels, you know, one thing that you'll sort of find, if you like, people who live in London will know, it's not very friendly to people who don't like stairs. And so every train station, you know, especially 6 years ago, it's gotten a little bit better now, but 6 years ago, none of the train stations I had to go to had stairs. So I had to sort of try and carry these 50 kilograms worth of luggage up and down flights of stairs, through little tunnels, up more hills, you know, none of the hotels that I stayed at cheaper hotels, because I just had a few paychecks sort of with me. I didn't save up for it. And so I stayed at cheaper hotels and they didn't have any stairs. So I've carried this 50 kilograms of luggage everywhere with me and nothing happens. no shock, no cardiac arrest, no nothing. And then sort of 18 months after that the first one, I'd got a job and I was working at an agency. And yeah, sort of, I went down, I was walking on my way there, and again, you know, I'd forgotten about it, but I felt that feeling, and I was like, okay, I kind of know what that feeling is now. But again, you know, this is only the second time I felt it. So I sort of, my first reaction was more, oh, I'm unfit, not anything wrong is happening. It's like, you know, oh, I've got to stop eating those chips. I've got to, you know, get this diet in London hasn't helped me out. And but I do remember at the time, and like, I find it kind of funny in retrospect that I looked into a window in a shop front that I was next to when I felt this feeling. And I looked white, like I was just pale, like ghastly pale. And you think I look white now, like I was, you know, there was a noticeable like paleness to my skin, and I didn't think anything of the time. Again, I just thought, God, I need to get more sun. I need to go get a spray tan or something. And so I kept walking, and I rounded the corner of the office, and I saw a couple of colleagues sort of having a cigarette in the morning over the sides. And I was like, okay, well, you know, I'll go say hello to them, and sort of hopefully the process of just going and sitting down with them will help everything calm down and go back to normal. And unfortunately, from what I've been told later, is that, you know, once you go into these abnormal rhythms, it's, especially with the VF, it's very, like, it's near impossible for it to come back naturally. You're either going to full on die, or you get a defibrillation or something to stop it from happening. It's not just going to go away. So yeah, I sort of sat there and it got worse, and I felt it come in, and then I passed out for a few seconds and when I woke up, one of my colleagues was like, "Oh, you're right," and I was like, "I think I just died." they sort of took a moment and ran upstairs, and again, naturally, just they called the paramedics. At this point, I was like, "I don't need a paramedic." But they sort of called one, and from that, I took it's partly my fault. So from then, a week later, this was on a Thursday. I went back to work on the Monday the next week. I probably should have taken a few more days off. But then I sort of went through the week fine, and then come the exact same next Thursday, the exact same time in the morning, I got to my office, and this was the event where I was walking up the stairs and I felt fine. I felt really good. Normally I'm a little bit hesitant with stairs just because of, again, it feels hard. So I sort of take my time, but I felt really good this time. And then just, I think, yeah, I woke up at the bottom of the at the bottom of the stairwell. So again, it's just one of those moments where you sort of put two and two together, and you're like, right. And sort of sprawled in this really awkward position up against the wall down on the bottom of the stairs. And again, luckily a colleague sort of came across me as they were coming in that morning, and you know, and as they would naturally do, they called the paramedics. But, so that was sort of, and then unfortunately with that event, I had so as soon as my defibrillator returned me to normal at the bottom of the stairs, my heart went straight back into those 8 seconds again, and I could feel it go straight back in. And so I went actually into a second cardiac arrest straight away as a rebound. And from that event, because I had the two in a row, they took me to a local hospital, and I had to sort of stay in observation for a couple of nights. But again, that was sort of, you know, I went back to work the Monday after I'd sort of been released from the hospital, and I was like, I'm fine. Yeah. Don't need to worry. And so I'd already had three cardiac arrests now in 2 weeks, and I was sort of back at work on the Monday. And in hindsight, again, I probably should have taken some more time off. And it came around, it was a Thursday, another Thursday, and the exact same time of the morning. And I sort of made it to the front door of the office. And this is where I sort of started to notice the physical effects that happened. So this time I felt those 8 seconds, but I also felt sick and I vomited. And then I tried to call for help on the intercom on the front of the door. And, you know, I've used that intercom for 6 months. So, you know, hundreds of times I'd use that intercom to sort of get into the office, but I couldn't figure it out. I didn't know what button to push, even though, you know, and I think that's obviously like a bit of hypoxia or apoxia. I couldn't think of how to do it. So I just sort of had to sit down and just think about my family and my mum and wait and hopefully, fingers crossed, wake up in a couple of seconds. And obviously I did. And it's quite funny, I got the same paramedic all three times, and in case
it's you again.
Make an effort. And he got his breakfast at a cafe around the corner from our office, and he said he's been in the line for a bagel every Thursday for the last 4 weeks, and he hasn't been able to get his bagel because every time he gets a call,
you die.
Cardiac arrest. And so I'm just like, oh, sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry I died. But, so that, you know, that was four times. And again, I at that point I did take 2 weeks off. I was like, okay, maybe my body's trying to tell me something. I should take a few weeks off now. And my company was really, really good. So they actually paid for my mum to fly over here to London. And they put her up in accommodation just down the road from my house. And you know, they covered all that and they paid for it, and you know, they're really amazing with it. So I've been super lucky to sort of be at the place that I work at. And so I spent sort of a mini holiday with mom, 2 weeks, just recovering and sort of getting back to what I would consider normal. And sort of, you know, a lot of these things as well, especially around that period after I had four in a row, I was starting to get a little bit of paranoia, and you know, I was starting to sort of double guess. You know, it sounds silly, but when, you know, I don't believe in the supernatural, but when Thursday come around again, I was like, right, I'm just going to stay in bed all day. I'm not going anywhere. I'm not moving. It's a Thursday. Once Thursday passes, I'll be good to go again. But yeah, so there's a little bit of sort of this sort of, like, I guess I spoke to a doctor afterwards, and they said, you know, it might be PTSD or something similar to that, just from sort of the events. And you know, and so just spent those weeks recovering from that and just sort of getting my mind right and back to normal. And unfortunately, when we all thought it was over and done, it sort of happened one more time. So it ended up being 5 in the span of 6 weeks. So to about 2 weeks after I went back to work, went up the stairs fine. Everything was normal. I'd been working for a couple of days already. Went down to get lunch and sort of jogged across the road, and it was raining. So I sort of did a bit of a power walk / jog to the cafe. Mm-hmm. And again, at that point, I was quite proud of myself. I was like, oh, look at me jogging and not like not freaking out and not worrying about it. And like, who says I've got PTSD? I just jogged across the road. And then probably should have touched wood at that point. That was probably the, so I walked up the stairs of the office again. I felt great. I was like, wow, like I walked up the stairs without even having to sort of pause or reflect or anything like that. I was really like really, really pumped. And then my HR manager at the time, she stopped me on the stairs, and this is where I started to go wrong, I think. So she sort of had a chat, and I was fine to have a chat, but I definitely wanted to stop at the top of the stairs just to take some deep breaths and and compose myself. And I knew I needed that. But I didn't want to be, I guess, sort of the British coming out of me. I didn't want to be impolite. So I kept talking with her, and she started to walk into the office. And so I was like, well, I've got to follow her. I've got to keep talking to her. I can't just stand here and be, like let her go when she's talking to me. So I followed her into the office and felt those 8 seconds. I was like, yeah, no, I've gone into it now. And as I was walking down the corridor of the office, I was looking around. I was like, I saw some chairs. I'm like, oh, I wonder if I just sit down here, will it go away? Like, will it help? And then I just sort of thought in my head, like, okay, well, I'll make it back to my desk. And when I get back to my desk, I'll sort of see if I can get myself out of it, which again, is impossible, but it's what I like to tell myself when I go into these sort of things that I can help in some way. So I went, got back to my desk, and then I sat down and woke up with one of my colleagues sort of cradling my head towards the ground. So again, just another one of those moments of, oh, okay, I know what happened now.
So that we are at number.
So yeah, so that's six, so six, that was four. Seven. So then we're that was six. That was the end of that was number six. Yeah. So number seven was actually, I need to actually look this. It's quite funny. I feel really bad, but I've died so many times now. I've actually forgotten the order in which I've died. So everyone's like, how can you forget that sort of stuff? It's like, well, you try and remember doing something 9 times. And, let me just. I've got like a list. I keep like a sort of diary of when these sort of things happen. So let me just sort of bring this up. But basically, I guess we don't really need to go into the details. Yeah. One of the next ones was at an airport. And so I went back to Australia to get my visa renewed. So it'd been 3 years now since I'd been, 5 years actually, since I'd been in London. So I had to get my visa renewed and went back to Australia. And luckily, serendipitously, I guess, while I was over there, my grandfather got unwell. And so my parents live in Newcastle in Sydney, but my other family lives in Brisbane, which is sort of more north. And so I had to fly up there to sort of be with my grandfather. And that weekend, my dog died, and then as well. So it's sort of, I get like, it's serendipitous that I was there for these sort of moments, because, it's weird that it all sort of came together in that week. And I happened to be there after 5 years. I happened to be sort of back in Australia for these things. And so my dog died that sort of weekend, and I flew up to my grandparents' house in Brisbane. And when I was at the airport, I sort of, again, it was, not to be, I'm not superstitious, but it was a Thursday.
Oh no, come on. That's really mean. Okay.
I have asked my cardiologist, is there anything, is it because I get to a certain point in the week when my body has had enough? I don't know. So it was a Thursday, and I sort of, in Australia, it might be sort of similar in some European countries, but when you get sort of to an airport, sometimes you don't have the arm go straight to the plane. You have to sort of go down the stairs, walk, and then you have to walk back up the stairs to get to the terminal. And so I was a little bit, you know, I'm still a little bit scared of stairs even to this day. And I sort of had my carry-on luggage with me. So I took it as super easy and really simple. And I went really, really slow. And I was walking slow for a reason. So I was like, okay, like, again, it feels hard. I really hate these sort of how hard it feels to walk up the stairs and how hard it feels to walk afterwards. And so I was slow, and my mom, obviously very sort of distressed about her father, and sort of she wanted to sort of get out of the airport as soon as possible to get there. She had sort of zoomed ahead and was well sort of on her way out the airport. And I was sort of making my way up the gangway towards the terminal, and Farron, like straight away I felt myself go into that. I was like, oh, like really? Like I was trying so hard not to trigger it. And I got out there, and again, like, I mean, at this point I should have learned, but my first thought was like, okay, well, if I can just, like, maybe I can walk it off. Maybe it, like, maybe it will go away. Maybe it will just to go away by itself. And unfortunately it didn't. And so I was like, nah, okay, I've got to stop. So I dropped my luggage and just sat down in the middle of the terminal. And I think that sort of raised a few eyebrows of people nearby. And luckily one of the girls, or a girl nearby, sort of asked me if I was okay. And I was like, no, I think I'm about to go into cardiac arrest. And she went and got the flight staff and sort of went from there. And it was one of sort of the more interesting moments in my life where, you know, the paramedics come and it's this big fiasco because you're in the middle of an airport, security's rushing over, like there's a bunch of sort of people involved. And when the paramedics arrived, they needed to do an ECG, which is the leads that sort of keep track of your heart rhythm. But because I've got a little bit of chest hair, it wasn't actually sticking to the pads. So in the middle of the airport, they're like, okay, well, we need to take off your shirt and we're going to have to shave your chest hair off. So there's 300 people standing around me and I'm just there like getting my chest hair shaved off so they can do the CCG. I'm like, well, that's an experience. That's I'm never going to forget that feeling. So it was probably the most embarrassing moment of my life. But yeah, and like, again, you know, my grandfather passed away that week. So it was quite an interesting week. And I guess, it could have been a lot worse in that we could have lost my dog. I could have died and my grandmother, you know, my mom could have been would have been devastated. So luckily, the ICD saved me on that occasion.
And what did your mom say, you know, when she rushed ahead?
So obviously I've been, you know, gone now for 20 minutes. I don't know where my mom was. I think she was well out of the airport waiting for our ride to pick us up. And I got a phone call while I was sort of sitting down on the ground getting handled by the paramedics. And I picked it up and, you know, it's sort of the relationship we have with each other. And my mom's first words were, where the F are you? Where the F are you? And I was like, oh, you know, I just died. And she's like, oh, again? All right, I'm coming back.
Today?
So she's like, oh. And like, she always blamed me for it. She's like, Jamie, like, goddamn, like, like, why? And I was like, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. But she obviously didn't mean it. And she was sort of more concerned about her father. So yeah, I definitely, there was nothing malicious in it or anything. So, but yeah, no, that was sort of, one of them again, there was either 7 or 8. And then sort of the most recent one that I've had was at a hospital actually. So since then I'd been recommended by the doctors here in London to sort of start talking about transplant, and sort of, you know, obviously this has happened 7-8 times now and it didn't sort of seem to be stopping in any sort of sense. And they've done a bunch of tests. They've done an EP study where they sort of fed some like wires and chemicals up through my groin to, like, I think they literally tried to kill me. Like that was the point of the test, because they just wanted to see how, like, what would trigger it, because they just don't know what was actually triggering these things. So they tried a bunch of things to trigger a cardiac arrest, which is really a weird feeling. You know, you sort of, like, I was in this operating theater and laying on a surgical table and all these guys, you know, sort of like looking around, and they're like, oh, we need you to strip down. And I'm like, okay. So I stripped down to my underwear and they're like, no, you need to strip down even more. So you're laying naked on this operating table, and they're putting these chemicals in, and they're like, okay, now we're going to give you a chemical that's going to try and put your heart into a cardiac arrest. And you're like,
that's how it sounds intriguing.
I mean, like, and so you sort of, you feel like your heart start to like really start going really, really fast, really, really fast, and nothing happens. So that test failed. So I think, you know, I think they've tried, and I guess they've exhausted all the other surgical options to help with my condition. So I think transplant now is the sort of, apart from medication, I think the medication at the moment's working well enough, but transplant is the only sort of viable long-term option, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so then when did you die?
Yeah.
and what day was it?
I'm getting lost in my side story.
And that's the other question. What day was that?
Yeah, I didn't keep track of that day, actually. I'm not sure what day it was. But yeah, so I was at the transplant hospital. I was getting an assessment done to see if I needed it. And a part of that assessment is a treadmill sort of exercise test. I think it's called an MVO2 test, which is like a oxygen something.
Oxygen.
Basically, you wear this sort of Darth Vader mask over your face, and they sort of monitor how well you take in the oxygen and convert it. And so I'd done that previously. This wasn't the first time that I'd done it. And in the past, I had started to get that feeling because I'm a little bit, you know, got that little bit of paranoia. Even if I start to feel that feeling, even if it's not the real feeling, even if I start to feel something like it, I'll freak out and I'll stop what I'm doing and just sort of, you know, try and calm back down to normal. So in the past, I had sort of got to that point where I had this sort of little mini freak out and I've stopped the test. And I guess the way the test is run is that you're not allowed to stop because they want to see how well your body handles sort of exercise at that level. They can't have you sort of have a recovery period, or like, you know, you need to sort of have that solid 10 minutes of data before they can sort of go on. And so this time I was sort of like, you know, I'd been playing tennis. I'd felt, you know, feeling fitter than I had normally. And I was sort of like, okay, I've got this, like, you know, I'm not going to stop this time. I'm going to last the whole 10 minutes and, you know, it's going to be fine. And so jumped on and, you know, it's going well. 6 minutes in, I still felt fine. And then just like a snap, I felt the feeling. And again, it's, you know, it's as, even though as determined as I was to keep going, I can't describe that sort of that dread that you feel at that moment. It's just, no matter how resolved I was to keep going, there's a deeper part of my brain that just told me, stop what you're doing. You're about to die. And so I told the cardiologist the physiologist who was with me on the treadmill. And I said, I just felt the feeling. I really want to stop. And he's looked at his ECG monitor to my side and he said, no, everything's fine. Keep going. And so, and then a nurse put her hand on my back to keep me on the treadmill. And then from that moment on, I sort of, that was obviously the 8 seconds. Cause I remember seeing him then slam the emergency stop button on the treadmill on the side. he's yelled out, I need some help in here. And then I've sort of gone down and, you know, I had a nice dream of a warm yellow feeling and sort of woke up and so looked down and the nurse was sort of pumping oxygen into my mouth and the physiologist was doing CPR compressions on my chest because they had actually turned off my ICD to do that
excellent.
Test.
Excellent.
So,
okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So it's quite interesting. You know, I do. They told me that they turn the ICDs off in this test to prevent a false shock. So mm-hmm. when you exercise, your ICD might sort of be tricked into thinking that you're going into cardiac arrest. And I'm like, well, the irony is I actually did go into cardiac arrest and you had turned it off. So yeah, they had to do the full CPR. And yeah, I was in, I think it was code blue. There's a blue light flashing in the background and 12 other doctors. Some of them still had sort of like gloves and sort of masks on. They'd obviously just come running from wherever they were sort of currently doing it. And they were just standing around me. And it was a funny moment sort of after I'd recovered a bit. One of the nurse that put her hand on my back, she sort of went over to one of the cardiologists and she was like, oh, it's weird. He said he knew it was coming before it came up on our machines. And I was like, I effing told you so. You know, like next time, listen. So I'm not just being unfit. I'm not just
sort of complaining for complaint's sake. And then after that, they obviously advised that I don't do exercise. And that, yeah, so, you know, I've sort of starting to feel a bit more fit lately and the last couple of months, and I've really sort of tried to investigate going to gyms a bit more, but gyms just are like, no, we can't even like begin to insure you unless you go and get like a written statement from the cardiologist and a sort of letter from the transplant hospital, and both of them have said no. So I'm like, okay. Well, but yeah, no, wow. So that was the last time it happened. That was
how long ago?
So that's actually been about a year now, or, you know, coming up to 18 months. So getting a little bit paranoid again, that it's the ticking time bomb in my chest is probably due for another one anytime soon.
Here comes the sunshine and burns away clouds like they never were.